Well, this Sunday, we're concluding the series that we've been doing on the Incarnation. I was going to schedule to do four, and Nate was going to do two. I got sick, so I did two, and Nate did four. But anyway, this is the final section. We're going to try to pull it together and zero in on some of the crucial points. We won't review all of the details, but just to remind you that we went through some of these things about the history leading up to the Incarnation. And one of those is back in Genesis 3, the promise that Eve would be the mother of all life. That phrase to her that God gave her is known in theology as the protevangelium. And it was the promise, the first promise of salvation. It was given to Eve. And for 60 centuries, that promise has waited while it's been attacked. The line leading from Eve to Jesus Christ was threatened many, many times, survived the flood judgment, and one in 2 Kings chapter 11, it got down to the fact there was only one son in David's line, and he was a baby that was that the apostate Baalists were trying to kill off the line of David. And thankfully, Joash's mother put him with a nurse, and they hid him for 6 years in the nursery. And that was the survival of that one little fella, and he was the one that kept the line. And then when we get to the New Testament, we pointed out there's two genealogies in the New Testament. One is Joseph, Joseph's line that Matthew gives in Matthew chapter 1. Then in Luke chapter 3, you have Mary's line. And the reason for having those two genealogies isn't because they're trying to repeat. It's because Matthew is arguing the way he constructs his genealogy is that Joseph can't be the father of Jesus. And the reason is that that line that Matthew traces is cursed just prior to the exile of the nation, when the prophet said, no one in this line will ever sit on the throne of David. So since Joseph is in that line, Joseph is in the cursed lineage, and therefore he can't be the father of Jesus, which is, of course, Matthew's argument to support the virgin birth. But then in Luke chapter 3, we have a complete genealogy, and that's Mary's. Some people get confused because at the last name of that's in that line is Joseph, which is Mary's husband. So why does Joseph's name appear after all these names from Eve down? And the answer is that in Jewish genealogies, the mother's line would be designated by her husband at the end. And you know this in the Hebrew structures because every one of the names in Mary's line has the article before the name, the article A. This is A, dot, 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 A, dot, dot, dot. But then when it gets to Joseph, it just gives his name. There's no article there. So that lets you know that Joseph isn't really part of that genealogy. It's a Jewish custom to honor the husband, but it nevertheless, it's Mary's genealogy. Then we had Nate has gone through some of the prophecies concerning that. He had a whole series on Jesus having a mortal body like our mortal bodies. And he gave a great exposition of that. Today, we're going to kind of summarize this with two big points. One is the historical perspective of the Incarnation, and the other one is the theological perspective of the Incarnation. Now, in history, because we're giving this whole 60 centuries of time, we have to say, okay, what do we learn about history that pertains to us? Well, we know from calendars You have BC and AD. So you have the calendar system recognizing the importance of the incarnation. That is until recently when they want to change the titles of the calendar. But the point is that the incarnation is the clearest revelation God has given to us until, of course, Christ returns and then revelation continues. But in the hymn that we just sang, there was this line in there, I am who you say I am. That means that our identity is defined by God, not by how we felt last week. And the reason for that, why that's so important, is we have lost in the culture a reference point. And I don't know a clearer illustration than John Stone Street, who's followed up with Chuck Colson. He has a great illustration. He says, imagine we are in the woods and we want to get out to safety. And we have a compass. The problem is, every time we look at the compass, it's pointing at us. Could we get out of the woods? And obviously not. But that's what happens when we fix our identity on how we feel. We fix our gender on how we feel. That loses the whole point. When we deny God's revelation, we've lost a reference point, an absolute reference point. It goes away. And with that, meaning goes away. So it's crucial that we recognize God's history of 60 centuries tells us human identity, and we are part of that identity. I want to go now into the slides. We have this slide that I've shown before, and that is God's revelation. Keep in mind that, again, we have to think in terms of two existences. Unbelievers have only one existence, just it's all nature. It's just all atoms in motion. From the biblical point of view, we have two existences. We have an eternal existence. God has always existed. God always will exist. Then we have creation, and we're part of the creation. We are not eternal in that sense. So God has to speak to us. If he didn't speak to us, we wouldn't know anything about God. So he has these two kinds of revelation. On the right side, he has general revelation, and on the left side, we have verbal revelation, and we want to just, again, review the difference between those two. The general revelation is a revelation of God's engineering in our environment, trees, the environment, animals, how humans behave, and so forth. That's all what we call general revelation. Why is it called general revelation? Because it's universal. It's always been, always, everywhere available. But on the left side, we have verbal revelation, when God spoke words into history. And the importance there is that is not universal. That is only areas that have preserved the Word of God, and it's not everywhere. That's why we have missionary work. But here's the important thing that we want to say about general revelation. These kinds of revelations make us responsible. General revelation makes us responsible. Every person is responsible for general revelation. Let's see if we get back there. We have universal responsibility. This is Paul in Romans chapter 1. Talking about how he viewed Roman society. Remember, Paul was an apostle who had to go out into the Gentile world. The other apostles focused mostly on Jewish audiences, but Paul went into a Gentile audience. Gentiles had no background. So Paul had to think, how do I reach these people? And the first thing he says is, let me give an analysis. And it's a crucial analysis. You probably want to write this down if you don't already have it. Romans 1, verses 18 to 32. From verse 18 to 32, his complete analysis of human society. And it's an analysis that works in our culture today. Here's how he starts it. 18. The wrath of God is revealed against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Now, he's talking about the collapse of a culture. That's what he means by the wrath of God is revealed. In other words, society apart from the gospel ultimately collapses. So he's saying the wrath of God is revealed against all ungodliness and righteousness of men. And now look at the verb here, very important verb. Why is God allowing a culture to degenerate and collapse? Because we are suppressing the truth in unrighteousness. How can we suppress? What truth are we suppressing? Well, he continues. Men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because what can be known of God is clear in them. God has shown it to them. That is general revelation. That is making every human being responsible. He continues, why are we responsible? Where have you shown yourself? And here's his answer. Since the creation of the world, his unseen attributes, and that's the verb in Greek, aoratos, aoratos, see. You make an A prefix, it means not see. Just like we have theist, atheist. So he's saying, since the creation of the world, his unseen attributes, and then it looks like he's contradicting himself, because the next verb is, his unseen attributes are clearly seen, and there's the same Greek verb, orao, to see, but it has a kata prefix, which intensifies the meaning of the verb. So he makes this contrast, since the creation of the world, his unseen attributes are clearly seen. Well, you say, how does that happen? Because being understood by the things that he has made, namely his ever-working power and divine nature, so that they are without excuse. So it's a compelling reference to human responsibility, and it means whether we've heard the gospel or not, we still ultimately in the depths of our soul know very well God exists. And so we can't deny that. We know it and we suppress it. Now, how did Adam and Eve suppress it? Well, the simple story, after the fall, they hear God coming. They hear him coming in the garden. Do they come out to welcome God? Not now. This side of the fall, they hide. Not only do they hide, but they construct fig leaves to cover their nakedness before God. Now, it's a simple story, but it repeats in our culture. And that's why I showed this other example. This is the first postmodern architecture building in the United States at Ohio State. And it's interesting. Here you have an architect designing a building with stairs that go nowhere, columns that come down from the ceiling but don't touch the floor. In other words, it's absurd. And it's an architectural statement that the architect here is trying to depict modernism, that all is chaos. And so he's making an architectural expression of that in his design. But here's the problem. In order to build that building, he had to use civil engineering. He had to use mechanical engineering. So here's the irony, and this is why it's such a graphic picture, and I keep showing this. It's because in order to have a fig leaf, that building is actually a fig leaf. It's an expression, I don't want to have fellowship with God of order, so I'm going to pretend I live in a chaotic society. But in order to pretend and make an architectural expression, I've got to rely on God's design. So the irony here is, in order to deny God, we have to depend on God. So we're building an expression of unbelief, but in order to express that, we have to build on the grammar. We have to build on the perception. We have to build on the laws of logic that he has given us. Then we showed another one. These are two of the great mathematicians in our world. And I think this is critical because mathematics is the tool God has given us to understand his engineering, understand his order. So here are these two men, Morris Klein, who for many years, he was voted the best teacher of mathematics at Columbia University. He says, cold symbols and formulas in mathematics, completely at the disposition of men, have enabled him to secure a portentous grip on the universe. Some explanation of this marvelous power is called for. Well, deep down, we know he knows where the mathematics, the order came from, but he can't express it academically. It's embarrassing to him to express this. So that's why he says some explanation, but he doesn't offer any explanation. The next man is one of the men who dealt a lot with theoretical math. The question of the ultimate foundation and meaning in mathematics remains an open problem. We do not know whether a final objective answer can be expected at all. So here's a man who's devoted his life to advanced mathematics, but he's using the very tool that God has given him, but he can't bring himself to express that. Now I'm going to show another example of this. So we looked at the Wexler building, an absurd design built on sound engineering principles. We looked at the mathematicians that are using complicated calculations in order to get things done, get to the moon and so forth, but we can't say where we got the calculations. Now here, this is a legalism going back into Jewish culture. This goes back close to the New Testament times. And here's what they did. In other words, they suppressed the Word of God and replaced it with something on top of the Word of God. Look at this statement. This is Rabbi Epstein on the Babylonian Talmud. My son, be more careful in the observance of the words of the scribes than in the words of the Torah. That's the Pentateuch. For in the laws of the Torah, there are positive and negative precepts. But as to the laws of the scribes, whoever transgresses any of the enactments of the scribes incurs the penalty of death. So in order to hold together their society, they decided the Word of God is insufficient. So therefore, the experts have to create laws of order and have to enforce those laws of order in order to keep a society functioning. So here are three examples of unbelief suppressing that universal knowledge of God, using that suppressed to express their unbelief. Very interesting. Now I want to go to something else that we learn as we go through history and look at what led up to the incarnation. In order to pull it off, we see in the Bible two things. We see there God uses the entire cosmos as a testimony to the incarnation. The Magi, we say, they were astrologers in one sense of the word, but the Magi were also astronomers. The Magi had actually calculations. The Middle East, they used it instead of the base of 10 like we do, they used 360. But the idea was that they had order and they had tools to measure angles so they could look at angles for the stars. And so the Magi are looking at this and they see something strange going on. We don't know whether Daniel left guidance to these the Magi to watch for this. We do know Daniel said in the 69th week of lunar calculated years, the Messiah was going to come. So they knew from that what year, and then they saw strange things in the heavens. Some people have said, well, that was the Shekinah glory. Could be, but it also could be natural phenomena that were exquisitely timed to occur at the birth of Jesus Christ. And it was noticed by men who looked at the stars. But then there's also an angelic component to the birth of Christ. And of course, in Luke, we have the story of the shepherds in the field at Bethlehem. Well, now we're not 100% sure of this, but we have on the Vatican Library, we have a book called the Archaeological Writings of the Sanhedrin and the Talmuds, of the Jews. This particular publication was done in 1887, but here's what it says in this volume. It says, Jonathan to the masters of Israel, servants of the true God, in obedience to your order, I met with two men who said they were shepherds and were watching their flocks near Bethlehem. They told me that while attending their sheep, some of them had lain down and were asleep. They were awakened by those who were keeping watch with the questions. They heard them, woke them up. What does this mean? Look how the light is. And when they were aroused, it was the light as day. All at once, the air seemed to be filled with human voices saying, glory, glory, glory to the Most High God. And happy are you, Bethlehem, for God has fulfilled his promise to the fathers. And then they go on. Their shoutings would rise up to the heavens. Now, this is a description of what the shepherds are saying, and I'm going to give modern justification for why I think this is valid. Their shoutings, and he's talking about the angels, their shoutings would rise up into the heavens and would sink down in mellow strains. And here we have a musical component. And we know music started not with humans. Music started with angels because the Psalms tell us when God began to create, the angels sang. So it's interesting that music that we use, and music has been used in worship, was first used in worship by angelic beings. And you think of the musical chords and the frequencies that are available in music. Angels were using this prior to humans. Their shoutings would rise up in the heavens and then would sink down in mellow strains, roll along the foot of the hills, and die away in the most soft and musical manner that they had ever heard. And then it would rise up again high in the heavens and in the very vaults of the sky and descend in sweet and melodious strains so that they could not refrain themselves from shouting and weeping at the same time. The light would seem to burst forth high up in the heavens and descend to softer rays and light in the hills and valleys, making everything more visible than the light of the sun, though it was not as brilliant, but clearer than the brightest moon. Now, you can say, well, that's just, you know, we don't know for sure if this is valid or not, but the phenomena they're describing happened in 1956. This happened in the Alka Indian Territory with the slaughter of five missionaries. They had made an aircraft. Alka Indians were an unreached tribe. They were a primitive tribe. And so the missionaries flew over that tribe and dropped gifts, food and so forth. And then one of the pilots had a neat way of taking his plane and orbiting in a slow formation. And as he orbited, he let a rope down with a basket on the bottom of the rope. And the natives responded with gifts back to them. And food, they put it in the pot. So what they thought, everything was great. They were celebrating Christmas at the base camp. But the strange thing was, the wives of these missionaries all had the sense, we may lose our husbands. And they couldn't explain it. They just had that sense that we might not see our husbands. One of those men whose wife was there was Jim Elliot. And Jim Elliot wrote this in his journal as a young man. He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. So these five men went back and landed there. Everything looked fine. And then a second aircraft was flying over to watch what's going on down there, and they see these Alka Indian men going to kill the missionaries and tear fabric off the plane. And they go back and they find the bodies in the river. That was in 1956. But in 1958, Betty Elliott, the wife of Jim, and Rachel Saint, the wife of one of the other missionaries, those two women went back there and were led to the Lord, were led by the Lord to reach those Indians. And they did. And they retranslated it and so on. And here's what they found out. The five men who murdered the missionaries became five men became not only Christians, but also spiritual leaders among their people. After they believed, they shared how on that fateful day, they heard singing from above the trees. Looking up, they saw what appeared to be a canopy of bright lights. And the missionaries are adding, God must be welcoming his children home. So here's another example. These are Indians who just reported this. And it's the same kind of thing. It's like a canopy that's above. The shepherds at Bethlehem saw this thing, this musical strains. They didn't mention anything about music here. Well, they said they were singing, and there was above the trees, and it was like a canopy. It's a very similar phenomena that was reported by those shepherds. So this is the historical perspective of the Incarnation. It involves 60 centuries of survival of the messianic line against all kinds of threats. It included cosmic powers of the stars. It included the 69th week of Daniel that was calculated mathematically with lunar years. It all worked out. The Incarnation happened. And then you have the angelic phenomena that accompanied it. So this is it's a powerful witness the Bible gives to the theme of the Incarnation. Well, that's the historical perspective. Now what we want to do is look at the theological perspective. Here's what the theological perspective starts with. In the Old Testament, there are strange passages that really weren't looked at too carefully until the Incarnation. The Incarnation forced believers to realize God is a Trinity. The Trinity is a doctrine forced by the Incarnation. We'll get into why and so on. But in the Old Testament, and I showed at the time, I showed some of the passages in the Old Testament, in Isaiah particularly, where you have these strange references, all in one, on one passage, where it talks about the Lord sent me, and the Lord sent me and gave me his spirit. Well, what is this talking about? There's three here. So this is a kind of a nascent view of the Trinity. Now, it turns out this church has supported John Metzger as a missionary. He's one of those listed in the prayer sheet that we have. John was led by the Lord to witness to Hebrew people. And he, in order to worship or to witness to the Hebrew people, he had to deal with these kind of passages. Because he had to show that we Christians who believe in a Trinity are not inventing this. This is implicit in the Old Testament. So he spent years writing this book. This is 900 pages long. And if you want to examine any detail about the Trinity in the Old Testament, John has it here. So work has been done. And here's the point. In order to have a personal God, you have to have him self-contained. He's not dependent on the creation. However, if we use the verb love, love has to have an object. You have to love somebody. Well, how does an eternal, solitary, monotheistic God, who does he love? Himself? For all eternity? So it turns out that in order to have an object of his love, he has to create. But if God has to create in order to get an object for his love, he's dependent on his creation to function. This is one of the problems of Islamic theology. So in the Bible, we have these passages of scripture. And these are unexplainable unless God is a Trinity. You have a loving Trinity. Internal to the Trinity, you have love cycling. If we can say this, the Trinity has a social need. It is a society in one sense of three people. The Father, here's one, John 17:24. Here's the Lord Jesus saying. Now look what he's saying. Father, I desire that they whom you gave me may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. And now look at this. They may behold my glory, which you have given me, for you loved me before the foundation of the world. So what do you deal with that verse? Clearly, you have the Father and the Son, and you have the Father loving the Son before creation. So here is why the Incarnation forces the church to say, we've got to articulate the Trinity. Here's another one, Colossians 1:16-17. By him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible. And he's talking about Christ here. So what is he saying? Christ is the creator. Therefore, he pre-existed creation. He pre-existed the universe. By him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible. In other words, the angelic realm was also created by Jesus Christ. All things were created through him, and all things were created for him. He is before all things, and then in him all things consist. He's holding the universe together as the Son of God. So clearly and forcibly, these passages require us to accept the fact that God the Son pre-existed creation, and the Father and the Son had a loving relationship between themselves. Finally, here is in Hebrews, the author of Hebrews. We don't know exactly who the author is, but he has a very high view of the Trinity, and he is talking to a writing to a Hebrew audience. God, who at various times spoke to the fathers by the prophets, that was the Old Testament revelation, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, through whom he made the ages of history. That's the word for periods of history. Who, being the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. You see, it's a powerful, strong passage about the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we have those passages. Now, when we broach the idea of the Trinity in the series earlier, I pointed out there are some ways of looking at it. I know there's some pretty sloppy illustrations of the Trinity. These are not complete illustrations. But years ago, the president of Gordon Conwell College near Boston, a Christian, was dealing with unbelief in the 1930s. And he wrote a book, The Wonderful Creation or something. I've got a second copy, and I'm going to put it in the library here with Rob. And he said, think of these. Isn't it interesting that time has a triune nature? And his argument is, not only is time past, present, and future, but it has a relationship between the future, the present, and the past, in that we don't know the future. The future is never experienced. It flows to us, and we experience it in present. The present is the only way we experience it. The future is unknown. It flows to us in the present. Then, when the present goes away and we have the past, we use the memory of the past to gain perspective on our life in the present. This is very analogous to the Father, who John says has never been seen, to the Son, who is seen, who is the center of revelation, the Old Testament angel of the Lord, New Testament Jesus Christ. So we have the second person of the Trinity seen and interacting with. And then we have the Holy Spirit that is unseen, but who has witnessed to us the scriptures he has produced for us to give us perspective on the Son. In one way, we can kind of, it's sobering to think, it's an insult to the Son of God to deny that his cross solves our sin problem. We don't need additional works. The cross sufficiently deals with our sin. To deny that is an insult to the Son of God who died. But then when we say the scriptures are insufficient, aren't we really insulting the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit worked through different people, different times, to inscripturate. So in one sense, we have the incarnation of the second person, and then we have the inscripturation of the Word of God that the Holy Spirit has done for us. That's why we hold to the sufficiency of the scriptures. Now, I want to get into a conclusion here about the Trinity and its impact on us socially as believers, our relationship to one another. But I also want to point out that the Incarnation honors the three divine institutions. It honors human responsibility, it honors marriage, and it honors family. And I asked if the people in the audio can show us just briefly a section of the Nativity film. This was a film produced several years ago, and it's a depiction of Joseph and Mary and what they went through. But there's one section in that drama that I thought was very interesting, because Joseph and Mary were young people, at least Mary was, and there's this scene where they're walking south from Galilee to Bethlehem. That's a long walk. In the movie, they show Joseph, because he's trying to take care of Mary, who's pregnant. Mary's on a donkey, and Joseph has to walk, and his shoes are wearing out, and his feet are bloody, and Mary's concerned about Joseph and his feet. But I just show you this because the Incarnation dealt with real people. So if we could have that section, please.
You've never really told me of your dream.
A dream?
No, please. Tell me.
The angel came to me, and he told me the child within you had been conceived by the Holy Spirit, and that I should not be afraid.
Are you afraid?
Yes. Are you?
Yes. Do you ever wonder when we'll know?
No, no one.
When he's more than just a child, will it be something he says? A look in his eye?
I wonder if I will even be able to teach him anything.
Anyway, the point here is that when the Incarnation happened, it wasn't that the Son of God was beamed down as a 30-year-old man to walk around. The Incarnation starts with conception. The Incarnation starts with a female womb. The Incarnation is dealing with a little baby boy. And when Mary went pregnant to her cousin Elizabeth, Elizabeth was pregnant with John, who would become John the Baptist. And what happens to Mary's womb when she talks to Elizabeth? it was Elizabeth's womb. Elizabeth is carrying the prophet John, and she feels a jerk in her womb because the baby in her womb senses the baby in Mary's womb. Now, people say, well, the baby's not really fully human. Well, wait a minute. Is the fetus, we call it the fetus because it's kind of impersonal, but let's think about it. Once conception happens and you have growth of a baby in the womb, is that baby alive or is it dead? Well, clearly it's alive. Second question, does it or does it not have a human genome? Yes. So now we just admitted that the fetus is living and it's human. So what more do we need? Obviously, we have a living human being. And then what happens? After this episode here, Mary and Joseph finally get to Bethlehem and the baby is born. So now the incarnation of the very Son of God takes upon himself, as the Chalcedon Creed says, we have undiminished deity united with perfect humanity without confusion in one person forever. That was the Chalcedon Creed, where they tried so hard to define words so we would be able to think through clearly because our vocabulary is clear. So we have that doctrine, but it's more than a doctrine. It has a life to it. And so baby Jesus has to be cared for by a mother. This is the Son of God coming out of the human womb, being cared for as a baby, just like any other baby. And then he grows up and he has parents. He has a mother and he has a father, even as a stepfather, but he have an honor of the family unit. He doesn't come into a home where there's mommy and mommy. He doesn't come into a home where there's daddy and daddy. He comes into a home with mama and daddy because children need a mother and a father. Because both the mother and the father have a different way of life, as any married person knows after 3 weeks. Men and women think differently. And so, and that's healthy. In fact, Jesus, later, he shows that God has a feminine side as well as a masculine side. And that shouldn't surprise us because he created men and women. But when Jesus comes into the city on Palm Sunday and everybody's throwing garlands at him and so forth, Jesus sits there and he says, like a mother hen, I would have welcomed you and taken you under my wings, Jerusalem. Now that's an expression of a mother. That's an expression of a female. And the Lord Jesus is expressing that. So clearly the maleness and the femaleness in humanity is both coming out of God. So we have the incarnation, we have a baby in the womb, we have a baby who is born, we have a baby who is raised, a baby who was taught by his dad and his mother. Finally, he goes to the temple and he shows his profound understanding of the law and so forth, and we have the dialogue. But the point is that the incarnation gives us the Son of God who comes to us, who comes like we do. There's no difference, even though he's deity, he has true human nature like we have human nature. And so now we have a God who is a perfect high priest. Why can Jesus be a perfect high priest? The Bible tells us he knows what pain is. The shortest passage in the Bible is when he's standing outside of Lazarus, his grave, and Jesus sees all the people weeping because this man has died. And what does Jesus do? Shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. Francis Schaeffer said years ago, the profound statement of that, Jesus could weep over the death of Lazarus without getting mad at himself for allowing sin in history. And it's a profound statement because we are responsible for the fall. But here's the bottom line. The bottom line here is that the incarnation honors the institutions of marriage and family. God used those for his own son. And that's a validation in our day where we have a destruction of the whole idea of marriage, that whole family is attacked because the government owns your children. No, the government does not own my child. We created that baby boy or that baby girl. The government didn't do that. And who raised them, who changed the diapers, the government didn't do that. Mother and dad did that. So this is the fight in our school system. Thank the Lord, we have Christian men and women running for local school boards across the country like we've never seen before, because people are fed up with the government dictating to us what our children are supposed to learn. So here's the bottom line for us as Christians. Now go to the Epistle of John. Here's an aspect of eternal life. Now, we often think of eternal life as something individual. When we are justified by faith, we have eternal life. But just these summary verses now. Look at what John's doing. The life was manifested, and we have seen and declare to you that eternal life. And notice this, that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. In other words, eternal life was part of the Trinity. It was part of a social relationship. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you that you may, what? Have fellowship with God or fellowship with us. See that? That's a social relationship. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son. And then later on, he's talking about Christians walking close to the Lord. And he says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. We have fellowship with God, eternal life, but we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Christ cleanses us from all sin. And then he says, a person who's trying to be a Lone Ranger Christian who neglects other Christians, he says, he who says he is in the light and hates, or it's word neglect, his brother is in darkness until now. He who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause of stumbling in him. So the conclusion here is that the Trinity was a social entity, a divine entity. We have eternal life that comes to us, but it's not given to us to be Lone Rangers. It's given to us to have relationships with each other. And that's the life of a local church. That's what Paul has tried to do to get started with the men's group, just so we get to know one another. Knowing one another, we should have in our churches, we should be the great support group like nothing else in society. So Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your word that is infallible, your word that is our authority. And we ask this to illuminate our hearts to our responsibilities in Christ's name. Amen. I'm going to call up for communion now. Nate is going to give us that.
Notes here sent from Pastor Mike about how he would do communion. I did make an edited version of his document in my own. Pastor Mike writes like he talks, which is that's a good thing. If you write like you talk, you're a good writer. We have the privilege this morning of celebrating communion together, and I'm going to preface that with the passage, if you want to follow along, from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 32. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy way shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a person must examine himself, and in so doing, he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For the one who eats and drinks judgment to himself if he does not properly recognize the body. And that means us. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number are asleep. But if we judged ourselves rightly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned along with the world. So at Fellowship Chapel here, we celebrate or observe two ordinances left by Jesus, and they are believer baptism and communion. And both are for believers. And they both center on him, and they speak of his identity and his mission. And they're practiced by us, his body. Now, Jesus has a resurrected body in the presence of God right now, at the right hand of God. But the scripture says that we are members of one another and members of Christ's body. The corrective passage to the Corinthian church about how they're celebrating the Lord's Supper is not really about individual behavior, but as they're not honoring each other in it. And so communion is something for believers to practice on a regular basis with each other. So we teach specifically here that it's a memorial of Jesus Christ, but as it said in Corinthians there, we proclaim his death until he comes. So that's his physical incarnation and his sacrificial death, and we know that he's ascended and he has a session with God and is praying for us. So in that light, we observe in his sight, and it says in the scriptures, in the sight of the angels. So just to, as a reminder, as an encouragement, this is for believers. So if you're not a believer with us this morning, we ask that you, that this is not for you, but if this is a witness to you, then we rejoice in that. And that is, as believers, we're trusting by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. And that's it. That's the only requirement of being a believer and participating. And then the passage about a worthy manner, again, the corrective thing to the Corinthians was in recognition of one another. It's important to remember that the Holy Spirit is in each believer and that we love each other. The Holy Spirit in me loves the Holy Spirit in you. And we honor one another even though we're different, in different circumstances, and we're to partake in harmony together. If God brings to mind any conscious sin, we confess sin, which the scripture means we agree with God about it, and then we thank him for his forgiveness. We don't need to morbidly go back through our whole lives. We're here to celebrate the Lord's death, which that is our justification with God. So we'll take a moment right now before the music plays, and then we'll come up in two lines, and just you'll take the elements and go back to your seat, and then we'll partake together. But we'll just all take a moment together to have fellowship with the Lord. If he brings anything to mind, you agree with God about your sin, and you thank him for his forgiveness. So let's take a moment together. Lord, we're gathered here to celebrate what Jesus Christ has left. And we ask that you continue to bless this local body, Fellowship Chapel. And we thank you that you've given your body for us, which you said is given for us, and it's our life. We ask that as we celebrate together, and even as we go from here, you protect each one and bring us back together again. In Jesus' name we ask, amen. So, in just a moment, you can all rise. The music will begin to play. You can form two lines and just take the elements here yourself. Where's Buck? He's going to take some downstairs. Is this? There we go. He's working on that little cellophane thing. Hold on. Yeah, it's a maneuver. Here we go. From Luke. When the hour came, Jesus reclined at the table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of God comes. Is everybody ready with the... And when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is being given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's eat together. And in the same way, he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup, which is poured out for you, is the new covenant in my blood. Let's drink together. I'm going to conclude us with a reading from Hebrews chapter 10. Charlie talked about Jesus is our perfect high priest. And Hebrews talks about how he's the perfect high priest, but he's also, he's the priest and the offering. From Hebrews 10, for the law, since it has only a shadow of the good things to come, and cannot, and not the form of those things itself, can never by the same sacrifices which they offer continually every year, make those who approached perfect. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, because the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have had consciousness of sins? But in those sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when he comes into the world, he says, you have not desired sacrifice and offering, but you have prepared a body for me. You have not taken pleasure in whole burnt offerings and offerings for sin. Then I said, behold, I have come. It is written of me in the scroll of the book to do your will, O God. After saying above, sacrifices and offerings and offerings for sin, you have not desired, nor have you taken pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law. Then he said, behold, I have come to do your will. He takes away the first in order to establish the second. By this will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all time. Every priest stands daily ministering and offering time after time the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But he, having offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time onward until his enemies are made a footstool for his feet. For by one offering he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. Let's rise together for a benediction. That's really it. That was the benediction. And I'll just say to you, that was it. I can't top it. As you go from here, thank you for being with us. Congratulate Caleb Eiler if you get a chance to talk to him. And encourage the elders and deacons. So with that, you are dismissed. Yeah.